తర్వాత ఫుల్ స్క్రీన్ చేసి ప్లే కొడితే ప్లే అయిపోతుంది.
ఒక సెకండ్ ఫస్ట్ అలా మీటింగ్ స్టార్ట్ చేయి. ఫస్ట్
స్టార్ట్ చేసా. ఫస్ట్ సర్ ని లో చేసుకో, మిగతా వాళ్ళవన్నీ లో
చేసుకో. మనలందరం చేసుకోవచ్చు. జస్ట్ అడ్మిటెడ్ సార్. సార్ గుడ్ ఈవినింగ్.
గుడ్ ఈవినింగ్. గుడ్ ఈవినింగ్ జీ.
గుడ్ ఈవినింగ్ సార్.
వేర్ ఇస్ ద ట్రయో? వేర్ ఆర్ శివ, రుద్ర, విష్ణు అండ్ బ్రహ్మ? హౌ ఆర్ మై హౌస్ మదర్? హౌస్ అవర్ పేరెంట్స్?
దే గుడ్ సార్. దే ఆర్ ఆల్ గుడ్ సార్.
That enna katrika which I had is still lingering in my mouth the other day you gave me.
That's nice. No, sir, I'll just enable. I mean, people are waiting, sir. Whenever you're ready, then probably I'll
I'm ready to go. Yes. Can you see my screen, Naveen?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Correct.
Hello. Good evening, sir.
Good evening.
Good evening. Good
evening, sir.
Good evening, sweethearts.
Good evening, sir.
Good evening, sweethearts. You don't have to call me sir. You can only call only Dr. Naveen, sir. I am only like uncle to you. You can say Ashwath uncle. You can say nothing, but don't sir me.
Okay. Fine. Okay, children. Good evening, everyone. Today.
Good evening.
Yeah.
Good evening, sir.
Good evening, everyone. Yeah. Last couple of classes, we had travel sessions from Gail Madam, right? We had been to Thailand.
Yes, sir.
We also have seen a session on USA. Yes. So today,
yes sir,
today our facilitator Dr. Ashwath sir, he is my teacher. Okay, like how Shravani ma'am and others are to you, Srinidhi ma'am, sir is my teacher, my beloved teacher. Sir is a pediatrician, very renowned pediatrician in entire South India. Okay, sir is got an experience of more than 25 years. So a pediatrician, how come taking a class of class on photography is something most of you might be getting amazed or query about it, but sir has this passion of this photography also. I remember almost on every Sunday or alternate Sunday, sir used to take rounds in the hospital, go out for bird watching and also photography. So whenever we plan to do this photography and travel session, also sir has this fixed schedule, I can say, almost of having traveling probably out of the country most of the time, sometimes inside the country also, yearly twice. So sir has this photography as well as travel. So when we thought of having this one in the workshop, I just thought of sir. I requested sir. At once sir said okay. So we are all so happy sir to have you here. So
my pleasure.
Up to you sir now. Thank you sir.
My pleasure.
These are a few of the photographs taken by sir.
Okay.
So please allow sir to share.
Yeah. There we go.
Yes, sir.
Clear? Right.
Yes, sir.
How old is the youngest participant and how old is the oldest participant, Dr. Naveen?
Sir, the youngest participant is 10 years, sir. The oldest participant is 16 years, sir. 17, I guess.
That's excluding you and your wife.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Good evening to all you young friends there. It'll be absolutely fantastic opportunity for me to interact with such young and bright faces. And words cannot describe how much pleasure I derive from seeing our ex-postgraduate students and valued friends doing so well in life. I have been a guest of Dr. Naveen and I've continued to keep my professional and personal friendship with him going. And I'm blessed to have lovely students and friends all over the country and even internationally now. I thank you and your team for giving me an opportunity to share what little I know about photography and travel. Over the next half an hour, what I want to do was just show the audience a glimpse of how much beauty there is for us to see only when we open our eyes to what is around us. As Dr. Naveen said, whether I was in the earlier phases of my career or in the middle path of my career, I've always made it a religiously ironclad rule that I will go and see at least two places every year. And it's also true that I do travel abroad a bit, but most of my travels are within the country to far-flung places because I believe Mera Bharat Bahan, and there is still so much of India that I have not seen and I would love to see and understand my country and my countrymen better. So if you can see these three pictures here, this is a picture of the Brihadeshwara temple at Tanjore. This is a so-called sannyasin or a sadhu who is very careful about his physical appearance, even though he is supposed to have renounced everything and is seeking salvation. This I clicked in Banaras, in one of the ghats of Varanasi. And this is just to show the striking color and the beauty of a rooster and its comb. So these are all random shots. None of these were premeditated shots. It is just that on the spur of the moment, you pick up your phone or your camera and click, and you record these memories for the rest of your life. And whenever you look back at it, it always is a very pleasant and very invigorating flow of thoughts. Without any ado, why do we travel? Travel is there basically because it's an immensely educative experience. It is like a college without boundaries, without subject, without fixed syllabus. You can learn, you can read, you can absorb so much, and all with so much of fun. It is not that like in an university, you have a fixed schedule, you have a fixed period, you need to learn something, you need to remember data, you need to reproduce data. Learning and traveling is so much more pleasurable because there is no fixed syllabus. There is no time frame at which you can learn. You can revisit the same places again and again. And every time you are open to that place and allow yourself to be influenced by the place, there is a lot to be learned from each and every place. That is for places which we know. There are also places which nobody has charted before. The Arctic Pole, the Everest, the depths of the sea, all these were all once upon a time unknowns. But somebody wanted to know what this part of the world, what this aspect of nature is like. So that is why your space travel, your deep sea diving, your paragliding, your bungee jumping, they're all basically categories of the third exploration of the unknown. So unless somebody is curious enough to see what that holds, knowledge will not expand and man will continue to remain in his own shell. The other important thing that I've seen is we always go after money, fame, some sort of materialistic pleasure. We think some pleasure is going to come at the end of doing something. But there are so many life values to be learned when we travel and explore other people's and look at their value systems. I will teach you with examples over the next 15 minutes what life values means. And again, we believe that sitting in front of the computer, having three big cars, having a decent professional life, a decent bank balance, a happy family life is all there is to life. However, when you travel, you see so many people with so many different life visions that it makes you ponder and think whether this is the way life should be lived or are there alternatives that people have explored. Therefore, to me, traveling is an immensely educative, but with enormous entertainment potential. That is why I love to travel so much, right? Why photography? You travel, you record your memories, you are not able to inspire, you are not able to share these thoughts with others. However, whenever you are moved whenever you are inspired, whenever you are struck by something, if you record it in some way, you're going to be able to share it. In today's world, sharing is almost instantaneous. We are all hooked and networked so well, like we have never been before in our existence on planet Earth. So not only do we capture the moment, we also have a permanent record which we can store someplace and relive those memories every time you want a feeling of deja vu. And remember, all these photographs are not just memories. They're all time machines. So every time you want to go to your wedding album or your child's birthday album or a school excursion, believe me, 20 years, 30 years down the line, you go back to that, you start feeling like a child of 10 or 11 when you look at an album which features you at 10 or 11. And therefore, you look at a face, immediately you trigger a train of memories. So photography is such an easy way to record, share, and relive memories.
So your voice is echoing, sir.
Are we okay now?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Yes, sir. Go ahead. Yeah.
So whenever we travel, the choice of destination, like I told at the outset of the meeting, we always consciously choose two types of destination, one Videsh and one Desh. One to see what your country holds for you, which you have not seen before. One to see what other people, what other races also live like, what their lifestyles are like. So if you go on a beaten path, you will see lots of tour operators. You will see lots of people like Thomas Cook, Sita Travels, SOTC. They will offer you very, very nice package tours. What is the advantage of these? You will definitely not go to Paris and not see the Louvre. You will not go to Paris and not see the Eiffel Tower. If you go to London, you will get a selfie before Buckingham Palace and the Tower of London. So they will make sure that all the must-see places will be seen. However, when you go with a tour operator, he takes the average of seeing what the average Aam Aadmi wants to see. Whereas your particular interest, for example, my son is a football freak. If you took him to London and asked him what you want to see, he will say, I want to go to see where Chelsea plays football, where Tottenham Hotspur football. He doesn't give a damn to whether the Queen of England is living in her country house or in the Buckingham Palace. So it depends on what your interests are to go and explore the place in a way that it's suitable for you. If you are a person who's very artistically inclined, the Paris that you will see will be very different from a person who's more romantically inclined. So the tour operators and guided tours that you will be paying for upfront will give you a very fixed tally. Therefore, you can only eat what is on your plate. You cannot change, mix and match. Therefore, the other thing that you could do is collect a couple of friends, all of you have shared interests, and then go as a group, because not only will you bond better, you will also find that your shared interests are mutually reinforced when you travel with a group. You could also have family trips where all the cousins can go. Most important, as you grow older in life, all you youngsters will keep making new sets of friends. You'll be part of at least 20 WhatsApp groups. Your LKG, your EKG, your primary school, your secondary school, your professional life. So you will find that there are some people you are completely in synchrony with, and these are the buddies that you will want to carry for the rest of your lives. Remember, when these buddies are bonded for life, you keep reliving these memories at your convenience by taking buddies' holidays together, leaving the rest of the family. It'll be very nice to note that when we went to Kenya about 7 or 8 years ago, we had a group of 5 people. The youngest person in that group was 70. The oldest person was 75. These were 5 gentlemen from Nagpur who have been classmates from LKG. Remember, these are 5 people who have been classmates from LKG, and they got together and said, we will go and see the rest of the world before one of us is no longer around to make these trips. So they had gone on a tour of Kenya and Tanzania. They did all their organization by themselves. And what is more unique is they cycled. Can you imagine, friends, cycling all around Kenya and Tanzania at that age, just to be together. So that is what friendship can do. And I remember the satisfaction and the happiness and their utter comfort levels with each other, and how much interactive they were, and what life lessons they gave to us in saying that once a friend, always a friend. So coming now to photography, less about travel. These are absolutely the basic parts of a camera, whether it's a telephone camera or a conventional camera. This all of you have done basic physics, I suppose. So light enters the camera through this part. And one of the most important parts of the camera is the lens, which captures the light and sends it inside to a prism. And from the prism, it goes into an area called the viewfinder, which is where you will see many photographs are looking into their camera. This area is called the viewfinder. What you see in the viewfinder is what the camera will click. That's why it's important to pay attention to the viewfinder. What happens when you shoot a photograph? This shutter here, which is blocking the light from falling onto the sensor, will fall away. Once the red color structure falls away, the light falls on the blue structure, what's called the sensor plate, and records the image on the screen. This is basically the fundamental principle of all cameras, right? However, when you go into the technical aspects of the camera, you find that the most important part of the camera is called the image sensor. This is the image sensor. Remember the previous plate, it was blue in color. That is where all the light images are captured. Nowadays, we do not use film cameras. We have cameras which contain sensors called CMOS. This is a semiconductor, and that captures the image in the form of light energy and stores it as so many pixels. Bigger the sensor, larger the sensor, more the pixels which can be stored. Therefore, the image will look more and more clear, more beautiful. Even small, minute detail can be captured. However, because the phone size is fixed and most phones have to fit into the pocket, you cannot have a large sensor in a cell phone. Therefore, your mobile phone sensor has a limitation of size, and therefore there will be a cap to the amount of light energy that you can store on the sensor of a cell phone. However, in a conventional camera, there is absolutely no limit because these sensors are getting bigger, they are getting more refined, and that's why the image pictures quality gets absolutely stunning within each and every avatar of this phone. Most important, today with so much of technical modification, you have Snapseed, you have Photoshop, you have Adobe Photoshop, you have Lightroom, so many apps are available where even after you click the photograph, you can modify the photograph by changing the light. I can show you some examples of how I modified some of the images I've taken. So even if you shoot a fairly average or even standard picture which you're not happy with, believe me, with the appropriate light editing software, you can still have some beautiful images. Now, most important, the most common camera that we all use world over, which even most of you might be using, is your mobile phone camera. What are the advantages? Obviously, it is convenience. You can put it in your pocket, carry it wherever you want. It's fast, it's easy to use. Most of them are affordable. Some of the better phones have absolutely mind-boggling camera specifications. And remember, you cannot make phone calls with a camera. Whereas a phone is actually a small computer. It's a mini giant fitting in your pocket. So he's a multitasking master. But what are the disadvantages of the cell phone camera, despite its so many advantages? Because like I told you, the sensor is small, the resolution of the picture will be limited. So leading to a poorer quality, especially in the dark when the flash is not up to the quality, the image's quality will be very blurred and very grainy. You will also not be able to edit too many settings. You cannot be able to change the aperture size or the frames per second or the speed at which you can shoot. Whereas with a cell phone with a conventional camera, with the same picture, you can shoot multiple frames per second and then choose what is the best. For professional photographers who want to control the amount of light, timing, shutter speed, mobile phone is definitely a nightmarish experience. So compared to the older camera, these present day mobile phone cameras are coming with even two or three lenses, which are allowing high speed photography with better and better resolution. Both these images which I put up here have been taken with my own cell phone camera. Somebody gifted a bouquet for our Diwali. So it was just lying idle in one of the flower vases in the clinic. The picture provided so much of nice contrast. You can see the white, the yellow, the rose, and the red color dahlia with a yellow background. With the proper lighting, even with too much of manipulation, you are able to get a very aesthetically pleasing, very eye-catching photograph. You can see this photograph. This is a stunning sunset. This is, mind you, not an edited or color modified photo. This is exactly what I saw in the sky about 2 months ago, late September. And you can see the beautiful quality of the palm trees silhouetted against the evening sky. So these mind-blowing pictures can be shot just as you go for a walk. You see something eye-catching. You just pull out your phone. You don't adjust anything. Shoot what you like. Take a couple of films. And then this is what you see. Compared to that mobile camera, the conventional camera, what we call your digital single lens reflecting camera. That's why they call the DSLR. D stands for digital. SLR refers to single lens reflection. You also have other point and shoot cameras, which are called mirrorless cameras. Broadly, these are the two cameras. You have the SLRs and you have the mirrorless cameras, point and shoot. Obviously, the pros are all the disadvantages we saw with the mobile camera. Finer details can be appreciated. You can control amount of light. You can control shutter speed. You can take very fast moving objects with amazing clarity. And you can also shoot videos and even small movies with audio backup. What are the cons of a camera? At your age, probably apart from the point and shoot mirrorless cameras, many of the professional cameras will be priced upwards of 30,000-40,000 rupees. In order to get the best experience of this, you need to have some basic knowledge of physics and some expertise and some basic photographic class. These are definitely heavy to lug around. You cannot obviously put a camera inside your pant pocket and run around. And in order to have a better quality of photographs, you need to invest in higher lenses, tripod, special lenses, and they are not as hardy as your mobile phones. And therefore, even a small mistake, if you get it scratched, it can put you back by a couple of thousand rupees. Having said that, the quality of picture, there is no comparison between the mobile phone camera and the SLR cameras. You can look at the quality of the picture, which I've shot on the left side and the right side. This is just an ordinary post-rain picture. You can see the clarity of the water droplets. It's looking like almost the plants have had a workout. You can also appreciate even the small eyebrow on this babbler. You can look at the color and you can also make out how many detailed reflections you can see of the primary feathers and the secondary feathers of this bird. You can make out each and every thorn on the cactus. So these sort of intricate details are not possible at this point of time with a camera unless the lighting is absolutely close and perfect for camera phone shooting. What are the types of photography? This is basically types of photography is to do with what you want to shoot. You can shoot natural scenery, which we call landscape photography. You can shoot people. You can shoot natural living things, flora and fauna. It could be plants, it could be butterflies, birds, wildlife. You could shoot places and you could also shoot monuments. Let us see one by one, what are the types of photography that we have categorized here. So, sorry, These are landscape photographies. Whenever you do a landscape photography as children, you should go to Wikipedia and your resource book and see some basic facts about the place you're going to go. And depending on the place that you're going to visit and depending on the hardware you have, select the appropriate time. Because if you go to a place which is very cloudy, going early in the morning for photography just doesn't make sense. Whereas the same place after 10 o'clock, when the sun is up and the lighting is better, you'll be able to get amazing pictures. Whenever you go and shoot a place, you should be prepared to see what am I going to see there? What am I likely to see there? So if you know what to expect, you can go prepared. You can read up a bit and go and have a better experience photographing this place. Now, the first photograph which you see on the top is the area where so much of trouble is happening. This is Ladakh. This is the Himalayas at the Pangong Lake. This is the place where Indochina border, you must have seen line of control, lots of warfare, lots of trouble is happening. That is this place. You can see the mighty Himalayas and the clouds there. Whereas if you see the sunset, this is at the Masai Mara, Kenya. You can see how beautiful the sunset and you can see a giraffe grazing before the night sets. This is another stunning photograph. This is taken at Kar Dungla Pass, which is the highest motorable pass in the world. This is from Ladakh, about 40-50 kilometers. You can see the snow in the background. This is where the Indian Army will send its people to Siachen Glacier. What is peculiar about this picture is these donkeys, which you see here, can walk in the snow without too much of trouble, where human people cannot walk. Remember, these are all employed by the Indian Army. These are donkeys which are employees of the Indian Army. You thought only horses and helicopters were employed by the army. Think again. You can also see these small cans here. These are all petrol cans which are taking petrol to run the generators for our sepoys. So these are very small pictures,
sir,
but they give you so much of information about what's happening in a place and gives you very unique insights into what is happening in different parts of the country.
Sir, they can walk easily in the snow because of they have a huge paddy feet, no, sir?
Absolutely. That is true. And you can also see the legs are long and the abdomen is very high. Therefore, the snow will not come and touch the lower part of the abdomen. And unlike our routine donkeys that we see roaming around the streets of...
They have a fat fleet.
Correct. And they have a very, very thick coat of fur which will protect them from the extreme cold. And they are extremely hardy. You feed them once, for the rest of the day, they continue to work. They're extremely useful animals. These and the yaks. Very, very well pointed out, Sashank. Thank you for being observant. So we go on to photography of places. The best advice I would give is if you want to appreciate the beauty of a place, do not take a gadi and run around. Do not go by auto unless you want to get from one point to another point. Go with your feet. Paidal mein jana. That is the best way to go and explore a place, because chote chote galis mein, you will not be able to move your car or, you know, or Toyota or whatever SUV that your family is traveling in. So if you want to truly know the nature, if you want to experience the flavor of a place, travel by feet with a light rucksack on your back and ask the people where the crowds hang around. Go and look at the gullies, go into the by lanes, see how people live, and you will be able to see very unusual aspects of even so-called well-advertised places. There'll be absolutely beautiful scenery, which you will see, which is not there in any of the traffic brochures. So you will be able to kick some amazing pictures of little known aspects of even very well-known place. And only when you interact with the local people, when you talk to them, when you share your thoughts, you will see the warmth and affection they have for somebody who's taken the effort to find out what their life is all about. They are very, very open. They are very happy to share their experiences. They very happily pose for selfies with you people only if you approach them with some amount of humility, grace, and some amount of empathy for what they are doing. Please don't look down upon them, even if they are living in poverty, thinking how poor these people, how filthy their living conditions are. They are people, mind you. So these are three pictures. This is the first picture on the left side. This is called the Tiger's Nest Monastery in Bhutan. This is a trek which will take you around 6 to 7 hours. You can imagine this is where the Buddhist monks go and meditate. From the base of the hill to get to the Tiger Nest Monastery, it takes 6 hours for an able-bodied person. And those people go there and spend 3 months, 4 months meditating on Lord Buddha and his teachings. You can see how beautiful the scenery is. You can see the pine trees. You can see the near impossible angle. It is impossible to even understand how 500 years ago somebody could move the material to build a monastery there in the first place. You can see how beautifully the mist is moving there. No digressions, obviously no Wi-Fi, no distractions. So this is an example of, I told you, how you can shoot a very ordinary film and give it a very nostalgic or give it a very 60s, 70s look by editing the photograph. This is taken at Vembanad Lake, which is close to Kottayam in Kerala. You can see the perfect silhouette of the fisherman and the boat on the still waters. And I have taken an image called Sepia, S-E-P-I-A. Because of that, it gives the impression that this film was taken in 1920s or 30s. This film was taken 4 or 5 years ago. So it will give you a very nice feel to the photograph when you can edit it. This green carpet-like structure which you see are all dew-kissed, mist-kissed, Valparai tea estates. You can see the beautiful scenery with the symmetric planning of the tea estates and that very nice green top which almost looks like a tennis court. Coming on to people, we photograph generally two types of subjects. One is family. Family people, it is nice once in a way when you're having a wedding, when you want to record how many people have come for a gathering, it'll be nice to have a class photograph or a group photograph where people sit and pose for a photograph. But when you actually want to capture the mood of a moment or of an event like a birthday or a shadi or a wedding, the best way to do it will be to shoot people when they are not actually posing. When you know.
Excuse me, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, I had a small doubt. Sorry to disturb, sir. Sir, in before picture, you showed a Buddhist monarch, no, sir. Monastery. Sir, how the people, yes, sir, how the people would reach there, sir, from down of their houses?
There are steps. It is not a house. A monastery, Sashank, is a place for meditation. It is like a Buddhist temple. The people who go there and meditate for 3 to 4 months. There is a small kitchen here, which will give you absolutely basic food to survive. Once or twice a month, people carry provisions from here all the way up there. Like I told you, it takes 6 hours to go from the base of the hill to Tiger Monastery. Once you go there, you stay there, you meditate, you pray, and then you come down. You don't make these trips on a daily basis. You carry your stuff, you go and live there for 3 to 4 months. It's called a mountain retreat. Okay?
Thank you, sir.
Yeah, you're welcome, Sashank. Sorry. So when it comes to photographing people, the best way to photograph people is when they're not posing for a photograph or when the photographer is a person they know. If it's a subject who knows you very well, they are not going to have any pose on their faces. They'll be very relaxed. They look very natural. Their smile will be very genuine and you'll be able to get their emotional quotient very beautifully in one picture rather than when you ask them to say cheese or ask them to photograph or pose for a photograph where it'll be a very forced photography. So when people in their comfort zone, when people are not actually posing, they will be themselves. So you can shoot much, much better quality images. They will get you a beautiful insight into the person's personality and not just a pretty face. However, when you photograph strangers, especially in a very new place, you should be very careful to follow what is called as photographic etiquette. Just like you go to a public place, you have certain codes of behavior. When you photograph strangers, especially in unusual places or new countries, you should always pause and ask them, "Ma'am, sir, can I take a photograph of you? Would you mind if I take a photograph of you posing or doing whatever that you do?" They'll be very, very obliging. And sometimes if they are not very economically well off, you can tip them, you can have a selfie with them, you can buy an article if they are sellers, so that to show that you are having goodwill for them and you don't want to put their photographs on your Instagram so that it makes you look nice. And it always is nice if it's an elderly person to give them a small eatery or something to eat, or even a small amount of money, just to show that you appreciate their gesture in letting themselves be photographed. Strangers, please ask before you click. Otherwise, you can get into serious trouble, especially in certain parts of the country. So these are four or five people that I have photographed. As the document above, as the caption says, it's more important to click with people than to click with a shutter. So this is a photograph of my dad taken a year ago when he was sitting reading his morning papers. I really loved the way the light played out and the perspective and the depth that you could appreciate and the color coordination. You can see this is dark brown, this is lighter brown, this is deeper brown, that is red. You can see the sunshade reflecting my father's skin. You can also see the oak panel windows and the contrast of the color. This is a lady whom I photographed 2 weeks ago. She's a cowherd in one of the Adivasi settlements of Kerala. So she was herding her goats. So I got out of my car and I asked, "Can I photograph you? You look so happy and so serene." She giggled and she was so thrilled that somebody could even pay attention to her existence. And she was more than happy to pose. And she was thrilled that somebody found her face worthwhile to photograph. She is not rich. You can see that she's obviously very, very economically underprivileged. You can see her clothes are definitely not washed or ironed. But look at that smile. Look at that million-dollar smile. That is the contentment that a photograph captures. It is the happiness. She is at peace with herself and with what she is doing. So when you're photographing, dear friends, you're not photographing people. You're photographing personalities. You're photographing life. You're photographing lifestyles. You're photographing somebody's inner peace and state of tranquility. That is what a photograph of a place will give you, which people will give you, which no photograph of a monument will give. This is a photograph or a shot on Diwali day of a baby who was born very, very premature, means he was born well before he was supposed to come to the world. And we were doing all sorts of treatment for him. It was almost like he was saying, "Hands up, bahut ho gaya abhi mujhe chhod do. I'm really getting tortured, give me a break." Can you see this chotu baby's hands going up and saying, "Hands up"? So this is also spontaneous. This is once in a million, it's a lifetime chance of getting a photograph of such a small baby like this. And this was my son when he was around 3.5 years, taken at Elliott Beach. Again, you can see that I've shot the film in color and changed it to black and white to give it that nostalgic look. And you can imagine, this is the first time he is having bath in the seawater. You can see the water waves rising so high. Yeah. It is quite different to bathe in the seawater and quite a different experience to bathe in the swimming pool. So that joy and the thrill that is reflected on that youngster's face is what I have tried to capture in that photograph.
Sir, sorry to disturb, sir. Sir, we'll briefly take a break for a minute and then we will rejoin back, sir.
Sure. Absolutely.
Yeah. Sure. Children, yeah, we'll all rejoin back in a minute, okay?
Please rejoin in a minute, children.